So about a year out of that organization, when this ISA agent got caught, it made waves all over the world. Because in 2003, no one had thought of catching an ISA agent using the internet. And at that time, both of us were posted in the valley and Hani Bakshi invited me for a celebratory meal. So with the advent of ICT, what has happened is the time taken for a new technological breakthrough to actually hit the market, that time is very shortened. And those same technologies have got a military use. The world order rests on military power, okay? The balance of military power. It's dominated by the US, which has got two main pillars. The one is the US dollar, and the second is the US military. GNR. GNR is genetics, nanotechnology, and robotics. These are things which will change the entire nature of warfare. In 2017, when I wrote this article, I did not predict war. I said conflict.
Conflict.
And it has happened because the Chinese interest is to bypass the Malacca Straits. It is the youth bulge, which is a threat to the national security.
Two decades ago, as the world was waking up to internet and its uses, Indian military intelligence was already using it to trap enemies. In early 2000s, Pakistani spy agency ISI got a jolt when its operation to carry out multiple blasts across India's capital Delhi was foiled by MI. The officers leading the operation were legendary Colonel Hani Bakshi and his teammate Colonel Pavitran Rajan. The ISI agent was trapped online and the operation made the world sit up and take notice.
Colonel Pavitran Rajan to me represents the typical the idea of that intelligence officers who have sophisticated, professional, competent, and I have actually interacted with him while being deployed in the Northeast, and I've known the work that he's done, and I really acknowledge the fact that he stands out amongst many of the super sleuths that we have had, and not only for his qualities of professionalism, but also the fact that he is actually delivered on his responsibilities that has been entrusted to him. And that's a very rare combination of people with, people skills as well as the intelligence, and yet, to be able to mingle with everyone and set a class apart.
We welcome the man who is called the master sleuth by his colleagues and the man who is much ahead of his time, Colonel Pavitran Rajan sir, to our show. He has done pioneering work in cyber intelligence and information warfare. After taking voluntary retirement, he also served as an advisor to Ministry of Home Affairs. Recently, he launched his first book, Engaging China, India's Interest in Information Age. So let us begin the show.
I wanted to know your evolution as a military sleuth to someone who was advising the Ministry of Home Affairs, to someone who then became an author on a subject which is right now a hot cake, India and China.
You've got me in a place where that's a very long story and not, many people know that story. But then, yes, so let me try and, put it for your audience in this way. I'm not originally a military sleuth. I'm a infantry man. I spent 10 years in the infantry in a regiment called the Sikh Light Infantry. And after 10 years, I moved to the Intelligence Corps. So Intelligence Corps, when I landed up, my first posting was in Bangalore, the Silicon Valley of India. And it was but natural that I am a guy who is of immense curiosity in a lot of stuff. So I then started, delving into the realms of cyber intelligence. So that's a long journey. Since you talk about Hani Bakshi, I met Hani Bakshi in my first year in the Intelligence Corps. That was sometime in 2002, 2003. He had come down for a personal visit. And then we had a beer off Brigade Road, Church Street. And that's the time OC, who was a close friend of Hani Bakshi, he told him that I was trying to do a small little experiment. And the army did not have money for it. That's typically because it went up and people thought that this is something which we should not do. The army is a conservative organization. And Hani Bakshi then told me, that time he was a major and I was a captain. And he told me that okay, you tell me what is your experiment which you want to do. So I took him to a cyber cafe and I tried to tell him, you know, what I wanted to do exactly. I could gather one thing that he was not technically very savvy. Those days, 2003, not many people were technically savvy. I just bought my first computer. But then at the end of it, he told me that I'm convinced, Pavi, what you're trying to tell me. That's the future. And he said, I'll send you $5,000 from a slush fund, which I created for such things. And then within a week, I got 5,000 rupees. And there started off my journey. Okay, I then started putting in my own money. I did not play golf. I don't smoke. So I started putting my small little bits of money. And that eventually started off the journey in where we caught our first ISA agent using the internet. This was way back in 2003. And then many more things. And then eventually it logically led to working with a great general of the Indian Army called General Huda the surgical strike fame. I served with him when he was a GOC. And he was a man who was, you know, if I talk about two people, one was Hani Bakshi, who gave me the initial spark. And then was General Huda. When I reached General Huda, I had a good spoken reputation. In the army, that's what happens. But he took me to greater heights and he did a wonderful job wherein the Ministry of Home Affairs started getting interested in what I was doing. And that's how I became an advisor. And then teaching the policymakers what is information, you know, what is Indian strategy and what is Indian need from a strategic perspective in the information age. So I think I've compressed the whole thing and told you.
Sir, I must tell you that Bakshi sir said what I saw that day shocked me. And he said, I knew that we could ace information warfare. I don't know. I mean, he'd not give me details into it for obvious reasons, but he was very impressed with your work.
So I'll tell you this. Once that ISA agent got caught, okay? He got caught after I left. Usually in intelligence jobs, the gestation period is huge, large. And usually your work fructifies when you are out of that organization. So about a year out of that organization, when this ISA agent got caught, it made waves all over the world. Because in 2003, no one had thought of catching an ISA agent using the internet. And at that time, both of us were posted in the valley and Hani Bakshi invited me for a celebratory meal. So at the time, I was curious. Happens. Yeah. So he was curious and he asked me. So I asked him, sir, one thing I could make out was you didn't understand a word of what I was trying to tell you. So what made you give me that 5,000 rupees, which is unheard of, right? My salary used to be around 11,000. So 5,000 was quite a bit of money. He told me a very interesting thing. He said, see, I didn't understand what you're saying, but I understood one thing, that you are 100% convinced and I decided you need to be backed up. So that's a sign of a great officer. That's why Hani Bakshi is a person I admire hugely, because it takes a lion heart and a vision that, okay, he just felt that this young officer was convinced and it needs to be backed up. But that's how the Indian Army got into this particular journey of cyber intelligence, counter intelligence, all those stuff. There you are.
Sir, in one of your interviews, I heard you mention internet colonization. And that China wants to dominate ICT and GNR.
ICT is information, communication and technology. And GNR means genetics, nanotechnology and robotics. A little research on this took us to an article from 2015, which said Chinese military scientists and strategists have consistently emphasized that biotechnology could become a new strategic commanding height of the future revolution in military affairs. This was further reinforced by a recent article which claimed that China is biologically enhancing its soldiers. China is apparently using a gene editing tool called CRISPR. We asked Sir to elucidate on internet colonization and China's attempts at dominating ICT and GNR.
So it was not internet colonization. The exact word was cyber colonization, which I used. But then internet colonization is fair enough. Those words have slightly different meanings when you use it for a certain purpose. So that's why I just correct you. If you see the human evolution, okay, the Homo sapiens arrived, you know, last 300,000 years. Our recorded history is last 10,000 years. And we have not changed much. From the time of our record history. And if you look at how humans have evolved, our brain and our, you know, our brain works because of evolution. Okay. There's a very interesting experiment where primates, capuchin monkeys, which diverged from us 38 million years back, their economic interests exactly work the way our interests work. That's a very fascinating, you know. So when you understand this, you will realize that the nature of man and the nature of nations, okay, will remain the same. So what China is trying to do is trying to fulfill their potential and reaching where they would like to reach. That's right at the apex. So in the last 200 years, we have the Western dominated narrative. And there is US who has created this present world order. And China would like to break out of that world order and dominate. But then so should we. What is the Indian dream all about? So with the advent of ICT, what has happened is the time taken for a new technological breakthrough to actually hit the market, that time is very shortened. Okay. And these are not research led by government institutions at a bureaucratic pace. These are, corporates competing against each other to get their products into the market. And those same technologies have got a military use. The world order rests on military power. Okay. The balance of military power. It's dominated by the US, which has got two main pillars. The one is the US dollar. And the second is the US military, because the US can just print the dollar, unlike the rest of us who have to work hard to earn the dollar. The US just prints the dollar, so because of which they can support a military, which is the next 10 countries combined doesn't have that sort of budget. The Chinese realize that they have reached the middle income, and if they need to surpass this trap, they have to change the world order, because the US has carefully crafted certain strategies to ensure that China does not surpass the US. So the curse of China and in one way, the curse of India is its large population. The Chinese population has just entered the middle income, and the world is, because of the size of the population, under one political authority, the world is frightened. Okay? Because they are going to be the largest GDP. Likewise for India eventually. When we rise, and if you have to pull the population, our vast populations, which are today on the edge of the poverty line into the middle income, the world, it will affect the world, because we'll have that, wealth to invest into, technology. So the world will react in a way where they will get frightened. Chinese are much more aggressive. So that being so, I have said that GNR is genetics, nanotechnology and robotics. These are things which will change the entire nature of warfare. And I see it happening. And we have a disputed border with China, because of which, if we do not, rapidly reorient our R&D ecosystem so that we can also ensure that the latent potential of our Indians are unleashed, we will lose out. And Indian history is all about India, militarily getting defeated and then getting further subjugated. I am not saying that Chinese plans are to invade into India. In the field of ICT, you don't need to anymore invade into a nation. You just need to get the data. And there you can control people, you can control the politics, you can control the economies. So therein is the threat which I am trying to highlight.
Interesting, sir. Now that you've mentioned population, and now we've gone through ICT. My next question is based on few of your statements, because I believe all of this is connected. Now, you are somebody who had predicted a war in Ladakh 4 years ago. To be precise, in 2017, in your article, you had mentioned it, that we should expect a war in Ladakh, right? And you also said that what's happening at LAC is a sign of war, not actual war. Actual war is being fought inside the hinterland. I'm not done. There's another statement where you said youth is a threat to Indian national security. I somehow feel all of this is connected. Am I right, sir?
Yeah, it's absolutely. All of this is connected. You can read it like a book if you know where to look. So, in 2017, when I wrote this article, I did not predict war. I said conflict. War and conflict. And it has happened. Because the Chinese interest is to bypass the Malacca Straits, where the Westerners in South China Sea is accusing them. Okay? And I knew if China is going to invest into CPEC, they would rather have Ladakh under them and Kashmir with the Pakis, because their national interest is to ensure that there is depth to defense of CPEC. So it was a very natural prediction for me to make, because those were the times of India-China bonhomie. And I knew this is an artificial bonhomie which will not work. Okay? And so I could easily make this prediction. Your next question is all about the youth, correct?
Yes.
So
the next statement that you gave was youth is a threat to national security.
So it is not it is the youth bulge which is a threat to the national security. Okay, we have the largest youth bulge in the history of mankind. Okay, that means a very large percentage of our population are youth who will need a rapidly expanding economy to get jobs and to fulfill their aspirations. So my prediction is, if you do not allow your economy to grow, okay, because world over, protectionism is, globalization happens in cycles, and protectionism is going to come in. People like you are today sitting in the Gulf. Tomorrow, I predict, in 5 years, the Gulf oil is going to, dry up, and you guys will come back. Okay, the new youth which is entering the job market will not get those jobs. India has been lucky that we have been able to. What is our largest export? Our largest export is human resource. Our best and brightest go outside to work. So, in next 5 years, that's not going to happen. Although there will always be a need for the cream of our talent, but the world cannot absorb this sort of population because of robotics, which is coming in. And the Great Reset, where they are planning to rechange the economic order, how it is going to work. So for me, when I look at India, what is our biggest challenge? If you do not address this pressing need of the youth, there are bound to be internal disturbances, which can be fueled by outside powers. Because if you look at the US or China, they would rather not have one India with this sort of population rise under a single political entity, because power finally is a zero-sum game. They would be much more comfortable in splitting up us into multiple, smaller nations. And I see that threat. So that is why I made those comments which I did.
Sir, are you also hinting at the different kind of protests which are happening on annual basis now and the large-scale protests?
Yeah. So social media. So this is something. Social cohesion is the biggest threat. It is not the youth bulge. And social cohesion is the biggest threat of India. How did India come to be subjugated by the East India Company? It is not that the East India Company just came one day as an army and just took us over. They very intelligently sided with different political schisms, exacerbated those schisms, okay, and gradually took us over. I see that happening today. Because if you look at in the last 4 or 5 years, we are the global leaders as far as social media-fueled protests are concerned. Okay? Our social political schisms can easily be fueled when big data analytics can feed individual information to people on their smartphones. People can be aroused and those schisms can be exacerbated. We need to be careful. So I've clearly said that whatever our choices, we need to ensure that privacy, which is a fundamental right, is made into a robust law. What is a robust law? We need to ensure the data is localized. Because if our data goes outside, then those laws will not apply. But today, that debate has been totally sidelined by the big tech companies because they see a threat in their profits. If the data gets localized, they see that, the Indian data is the most richest data in the world because we are so varied. Okay, and artificial intelligence, which is going to disrupt this entire global economy, runs on continued flow of data. So we need to put a stop to this data flowing first out to ensure that our people are not profiled and our social cohesion is not disturbed. The next thing is just saying that let us localize will not do. Because what do you see? every appliance which you see is backdoored and they're stealing the data. So for critical infrastructure, especially the core part of our ICT and the critical information infrastructure, needs to be on indigenous products. Today,
are you hinting at OEM?
Yes, indigenous. The OEM needs to be Indian. So the control of that products remain with us.
So these are words I learned from your article only. Otherwise, I did not
know. Okay, the jargon of any particular this, I just hung my boots 7 years back. But I've been studying this jargon for the last 16, 17 years. So I understand this jargon and I picked it up. So the OEM is the original equipment manufacturer. Our routers, our firewalls, etc. need to be Indian. Not because being Indian will ensure foolproof security. I mean, because security by its very nature, there is nothing called foolproof.
Mm.
Okay? It is only levels of security and all security systems can be bypassed by human ingenuity. But then what matters is, firstly, is the OEM trusted? Okay? Is it yours under your law? And the second is, when it is breached, how fast can you ensure the breach is closed? That is resilience. So there are only two things which count, trust and resilience. But the brilliance of the Western world is, they created so much of literature and jargon where they managed to fool the rest. After Snowden, the rest of the world has changed. In India, a lot of people who have been dependent on the ITES industry and a lot of our policymakers seem to be, have bought into narratives which are not of Indian interest. I've clearly written about this and a lot of other people have started agreeing with me. Back to you.
So, as a solution, you had also mentioned something like InQtel, which is a venture capital firm. And it has CIA's involvement. I found that very interesting. Can you just explain that in Indian context?
Okay. So when I was posted in Bangalore in 2002 was the time when I met a whole lot of bright youngsters who all wanted to start up their companies. And they all wanted to have an office in the US. Okay. A brilliant bunch of guys. So when I slowly started understanding why did they want to go to the US, and all of them were aspiring for a fund called the InQtel. So when I started looking, digging up on InQtel, there was a Bangalore company those days called Purple Yogi. Purple Yogi was taken over by InQtel. And there was a small news article which cropped up, which said, oh, CIA has taken over this company. And then it died down. So when I started digging out, what is this InQtel? I found that it is a fund of 100 million, which is being done by the US Congress. And give it to the CIA, where it acts as a incubator for technologies globally, which will benefit the US. So all people, all over the youngsters, all over the world will try to get this recognition or funding from InQtel. Because on InQtel website, they clearly say, for every $1 we put, the rest of the venture capitalists will put $9. So that is how you don't ensure that your public money is not wasted into creating a huge, I would say, white elephants, the way we do. Because in the venture capital field, you fail fast. If you don't grow and if you don't show potential, they will just cut out the funding and that's it. It's a loss which they take. In India, the taxpayers' money is, once bureaucracy gets its hand on it, it will keep growing. It will never, nothing fails. And they will ensure policy is created in such a way that they still remain relevant. And that I today see is the biggest, problem for Indian R&D to take off and Indian innovation to take off. We need to change them rapidly. In India, what is happening is the Indian bureaucracy, they do not want to leave control. So they have prevented this particular, we have been pressing this for so many years now, but they have prevented this. And if you ask them, how do you fund private companies? They are still working out rules. There is no rule where you can fund a private company. Okay. You have to leave control. You have to create this venture capital fund, which will be run by intelligence organization, okay, and who will employ professional fund managers. Because how do the fund managers run this company? It is not they are given very big salaries. Fund managers have just subsistence salaries. But what he gets is a substantial part of the profit when it is made. He gets percentages of the profit. So these guys become millionaire co-terminus with the growth of the fund. So bureaucracy cannot run this.
Hmm. Interesting, sir. That also reminds me of one of your articles, The Fallacy of Cyber Commons, which is a brilliantly researched article, I must say. And you said that there's a physical layer of cyber commons which should be based on non-territorial platforms, preferably space-based. And then you said data generated should be stored within the territorial jurisdiction. Okay. So I wanted to understand this in a little more detail, because are we ready for something, you know, like the cyberspace where we can store this?
So let me try and make you understand the concept of commons. Commons is a term originally articulated by a brilliant admiral of the US Navy called Thayer Mahan. Okay. He said any space which does not have sovereign jurisdiction of a nation, that is the high seas, space, air, all these domains where a national sovereignty is not, does not extend to, is commons. So when the US tried to push internet into the world, okay, the internet was made by the DARPA for population control. It started off, if you look back into the origins of the internet, you will reach the Vietnam War. US was fighting, losing insurgency, and they realized the war is all about population control. So DARPA, the origins of the internet is about population control. It's got nothing to do with commerce. It's got nothing to do with communication. It is all about population control. That is where eventually we are reaching. If you get the data of people, you can control them. Okay. So the US, when you try to push such a narrative, you had to have a lot of people who are used to talk about global village, the earth is flat. A lot of economists, intellectuals started, you know, they were all weaponized. Some willingly, maybe some not willingly. None of these people today are saying, oh, the earth is flat or it's a global village. Okay. Because the true nature of the internet is slowly start coming. It's a domain of conflict like anything about to do with man. So the US pushed the concept of commons. A lot of people buy into it because great, no? Oh, it's a commons created for the common good of man. That is just rhetoric. If you dig slightly deeper, you'll realize the Americans have ensured that 100% control remains with them. Because the root servers, which control the domain DNS, is still controlled by the US. They have now said it's multinational, what is the term? Is there, you know, I like the Americans, you know, they make such beautiful terms. Okay. So ICANN is the organization which controls it. And that has been declared into a non-profit, and seemingly other non-profits and civilian bodies, etc., are all supposed to be people who run this organization. But the fact remains, the actual root servers only exist in the West. Maximum number of them in the US, one odd in Singapore and one odd in Japan. So physically, that can be switched off. Okay, if you switch that off, the whole internet, as you what you see it, will within a week will shut down. Okay, the US has openly talked about a kill switch. So if you look at India and our declared policy of sending 100% of our economy into the internet, how can you send your entire economy into a domain which can be switched off by someone else? Are we fools? Don't we have a history? Have we not seen that whenever foreigners have come and exerted control, they have finally taken over and subjugated you? So I ask those fundamental questions. So I have said the concept of a cyber commons can only be true that if the platforms are space-based, that means no one can go and switch it off. The local police guy cannot go with a lathi and say, hey, shut down this server. It's space-based and it is under the UN. Then you can say, yes, it's a cyber commons. That will never happen. You will see, it will never happen. Yeah. Okay, but I said, if that happens also, the data has to be as long as nations exist within their own jurisdiction. Okay, so that is what I meant in that particular thing.
So, so in your book, you have given suggestions on how this is to be countered.
Let me clarify. This is not a book which I one fine day decided to write on my own. This book was, You know, in fact, people from a Delhi-based think tank called the Policy Perspective Foundation, they whom, you know, they are people from mostly the intelligence services and academicians. They approached me and said, because since they had been, you know, we had been working along in policy pushing, they said, okay, you're one of the people whom we think can write this book. So they told me write this monograph, and they told me how do we ensure that Indian national security is protected if, you know, friction happens with China. This was before the thing happened in Leh. If we have to stay relevant and be ready to protect national interests and national security, to create a indigenous ecosystem of ICT companies. There's no other way.
That's a great note to end this interview at.
Thank you. It was fun talking to you too, Lavina.